The journey to visit the house where our grandfather Giuseppe Materazzo grew up begins with
motoring along the freeway from the city of Catania up the east coast of Sicily, through the town of Messina, and around to the beautiful port town of Milazzo, one of those typical picture postcard Sicilian towns where people come to vacation and enjoy the Mediterranean lifestyle in their little runabouts and things. Just like birds of a feather, a rainbow together we'll find. After sampling some of the local cuisine, we've booked ourselves onto the only hydrofoil ferry that operates in the winter season to take us on our trip to the island of Salina. As the hydrofoil gently lifts us out of the water with speed, it takes us on the ocean part of our journey, around the base of the island of Lipari, up to the island of Salina.
Salina, on the island of Salina, and we're about to catch a bus to go to Marfa.
Have a look at the clarity of the water.
As we board the bus for the final stage of our trip to the opposite side of the island, I start to think to myself about where we're going, but more importantly, who was there before us. To find out this, we go back 112 years to the 3rd of March 1892, where Gaetano Materazzo married Rosalia Davola and started a family, eventually having 12 children, with one dying at birth. Their third son, Giuseppe, and our grandfather, pictured here on the right, in 1914, at the age of 19, decides to leave Malfa and migrate to Australia. This composite photograph, mostly constructed from wedding photographs, shows what the family may have looked like if a family reunion had ever taken place. It shows Giovanni, Domenico, Giuseppe, our grandfather, Lorenzo, Vincenzo, Gaetano, Erminia, Assunta, Antonio, the parents Rosalia and Gaetano, Caterina and Generosa. Giovanni and Gaetano immigrated to the United States. The rest of the children, over the 1900s, eventually immigrated to Australia.
Here we are in Malfa. We just believe it or not, Papa's house sits behind this huge mountain. Sits in front of this huge mountain. This huge mountain is right behind the house.
And this is where, when you get off the bus, you walk up the hill a bit, and Papa's house is just over here behind the bank.
Up there is the little house behind the house that we're looking at. Up the back there.
Here we go.
This walkway, all the way down from there. The people that are looking after the house are going to get us the key. This is it. This is Papa's house in front of the mountain. So this is the house. We just walked up the hill. About to go to the door. View from Papa's house. Isn't it fantastic? Talk about a castle on top of the hill. I don't know, but what a view. No power. Okay, va bene. Grazie. So here's the house. Have a look at this. An old stone oven underneath it. The kitchen is up through the stairs. Here's the kitchen. Little tiny kitchen. It's about 10 feet long by about 5 feet wide. Absolutely small as anything. It's been obviously renovated and installed a bit with new stuff. And here are the ovens down here that obviously Papa's mother
used to. Look at the roof. The old roof. And that old oven. It's just amazing how that's probably what they cooked in, you know, 100 years ago here. 80 years ago, 90 years ago. More. And then we're going to go upstairs. Miguel, he's from the family that looks after the house in the winter. And look at the old locks and keys. It's absolutely fantastic. Look at the old roof. He's opened up the terrace window for us. Or the terrace
this
terrace.
Is a view that maybe Papa or his father had from the room. We're above the terrace now. And this is one of the bedrooms.
Again, look how it was built in those days. That's just amazing. Fantastic. So this is one of the main bedrooms. Could have been a main bedroom. And then there's another door through here. We're in the second room. And I think it's maybe even more. Early. 18th. Have to be earlier than that. Presuming. He's presuming it's that. Look at that. This is out of the terrace from the second bedroom.
The balcony you're looking at now, 93 years earlier, gave us one of the very few family photographs ever taken of the Materazzos. And it's not too hard to imagine them sitting there right now.
This is the view from the window. From the bottom of the stairs, where you come up, you go right to the bedrooms, or you turn left out into the courtyard. And this is the roof of Papa's house here. And they would probably sit out here on some days and look over here, the city of Malfa. And look at the view. It is just absolutely fantastic. This is the view from the house. It's like probably one of the highest houses here in the town. A lot of building and construction going on, but amazingly, fantastic location. Look at this. This is another bedroom, or workroom maybe, or something like that. Look at this. Look at the way the bottom of the bed is made. This is another bedroom, but look how it's made. It's made out of like concrete with a solid base, with cupboard space, and the bed on top. And the roof has obviously been reinforced.
This has been here since 30 years.
Okay.
The only thing that's new is this.
Right.
Okay, that is original.
That's original. Yeah. Wow. So we've been up there. We've been up there. Each room has a terrace. In there is the main room. In the other rooms, that's for the steps. Now we go to the last room. Here's Rusty, Papa's old dog. He's still alive, believe it or not. He's 140 years, this dog.
It's original. The only thing is that piece of wood around the fire.
Wow.
Not the room is original.
So this is the most original. Okay, hang on, I'm just getting the roof. So this is the most original part of the house, like from the old days. The roof was thatched with wood. That came down to a fireplace. There's a fireplace there. This might have been like the lounge room, I would say. And then we go through to this, which is what?
Where they kept the water.
This is a well or something?
Not the well, but where they kept the water to drink.
This was a place where they kept water to drink. This is an old saddle for a donkey that's been here since time began.
Fantastic. That's
always been there.
That's always been there.
Yeah.
This has always been here, this lemon tree and the other tree have always been here. So guess what? Lemon trees run in the family. Dad, your lemon tree's been there for as long as I can remember. And have a look at this. If this doesn't look like your lemon tree at home, I don't know what it is. You must have had a seed put in your hair when you got home or something. This is the backyard. This is also...
Sempre stata.
Washing machine. Washing thing.
Yeah, where they used to wash their clothes.
This is where they used to wash their clothes. Look at this. This is where you... They used to wash the clothes. Fantastic. Absolutely. Show the back of the house. This is the original wall, the back wall of the house in the back garden. Look at this. This tree, this is an orange tree. One side of this tree is sweet oranges, and the other side of this tree is sour oranges. So it's been crafted, or grafted. And that's what Dad's done as well. All original beams and structure of the original house as well. And that's where we came in, to the side of the house. So this is the Materazzo Casa in Malfa. Big house. It would have been definitely regarded as a rich house. With all the bedrooms and family rooms and well, kitchen, back room, toilets, balconies, and this amazing view again. This house here, which is in front of Papa's house, used to be a horse stable. It used to be a horse and donkey stable. Now, the family that takes care of this house in the winter lives in that house. So that was a stable to this house.
This vineyard, which is located right beside the house, was also part of the Materazzos. This experience of visiting and touching our grandfather's house has had a far more deeper effect on me than I expected. And as we go to leave, a wave of emotion passes over me, feeling some connection to this stone and mortar that once represented the beginning of our family. So as we depart from the port and look back at Salina, I can only imagine what emotions were going through Papa's mind as he waved goodbye to his parents and boarded a boat similar to this, to bravely begin a new life in Australia. In 1914, a young 19-year-old Joseph Materazzo arrives in Melbourne to start his new life. He soon moves to Sydney and works there with Italian friends in a fruit shop for 3 years, before returning to Melbourne to start his first shoe shop business in St Kilda. Companies soon recognise Papa's skill and high-quality craftsmanship in making footwear, and secures a contract to supply the Cootie's ballet shoes, which cements his career in the footwear industry. Now that he has established himself, within 3 years, he meets, courts, and marries Teresa Ventris on October 30th, 1920. And so as they focus on developing their life and having a family, they have their first child, a son, Gaetano or Tom. And then, by 1923, the Materazzos move to Harding Street, Coburg, where they build a house with a shop front. This becomes the place where the family grows, the business develops, and the future of the Materazzos begins. So through the 20s and the 30s, the rest of the children are born. Here we see Rosa, Mary, and Tom. Then seated on the chair in the middle is Lena. Then with the whole family, there are 4 girls and 2 boys. Irene, Joseph here, Mary, Tom in the middle, Rosa, Teresa the mother, and Lena. And with Vincent in the middle, he got the nickname of Mussolini. He struggled at birth, the hospital didn't think he would survive, but he fought so strong and hard that he earned even a newspaper article calling him Vincent Mussolini Materazzo. And as they grew up, they always remained close. And here's one of the great shots of Mum and the girls at one of the many family parties they would have at Harding Street. The always stylish, well-dressed Papa, cigar and all. Then came that time in life when you become the proud parents and you give away your girls on their special day. Nana and Papa were very proud. And as expected, the family grew. The girls got married, the boys got married, and started having kids of their own. And Nana and Papa started to become the proud grandparents. From what I've been told, Nana and Papa were always close. Always beside each other, always supporting each other. They were great grandparents. Always loving, always caring. But unfortunately, in 1962, Nana passed away, leaving Papa. He still celebrated many birthdays with his children and grandchildren, whom he loved very much. He even looks after one special one today. Sadly, in 1967, Papa passes away. He now rests beside Nana. And I know that both of them watch over us all. Tom married Margaret and had 5 kids who are all doing well today. Rosa has her 2 boys and had a wonderful life with Keith. Mary married Cliff Whitworth and had 3 beautiful daughters. Lena married Kevin Donnelly and had 3 boys. Irene married Robert Brown, who we know as Uncle Jack, and they had 2 beautiful daughters. Uncle Vince married Margaret and had 5 wonderful kids. Uncle Vince has also spent the last 20 years developing a family tree on paper. He's gone to exhaustive lengths, contacting people overseas, and methodically drawing out all the descendants right up until current date, and done an outstanding job. And all the brothers and sisters have remained close and still catch up with each other and celebrate birthdays and special occasions many times a year. I'd like to give a special thank you to Uncle Vince for his time, information and dates on the family tree. A special thank you to my first cousin Rosalie, who first helped me with my trip to Italy and then in acquiring all the photos and information for this video. And to thank all my aunties for parting with their precious photos. My special memory of Papa is sitting on his knee, poking holes in the newspaper with his cigar. That will stay with me forever. I hope you enjoyed this video, and I hope it helps the rest of the family.